Welcome to Let's Face the Facts, the rewatch podcast for the classic sitcom, The Facts of Life. Join us each week as we synopsize, analyze, criticize, and ultimately idolize the show. And now, here's your host of Let's Face the Facts, the wonderful David Almeida.
Thank you, Matthew Arter. Welcome back.
Welcome.
It's another week. No, I'm doing the normal. Just hold on 1 second, okay? It's another week, another show. Thank you for downloading and pressing play. This week, we're going to be discussing Season 8, Episode 18, 62 Pickup, which had an original air date of February 21st of 1987. We are already on the Zoom, and Matthew is already here, as you may have heard. Hi, Matthew.
Hi, David. I have my cards. I'm ready to play 52 Pickup.
Yep. What a interesting reference to that as a game. There is no card playing per se in the show, but to say, oh, let's do it 62. And I mean, it makes no more or less sense than any other title that we've had. Let's talk some nuts and bolts, huh?
I would love to talk about your nuts and bolts.
Okay. This episode was written by Phil Doran and Douglas Arango. If you remember those names from the past, they are writing partners. They're supervising producers who are in every single credits that roll at the end of the episode. They came aboard at the beginning of this season and will be staying with the show through the end of the entire series. As writers, this is their third of five episodes. Previously, they wrote The Little Chill. Oh, we had issues. Oh, the issues with The Little Chill. And they also wrote Where's Papa, which we kind of liked. That's the one where Blair's dad was on trial for insider trading. And we learned that he was taking the bullet for his own dad, which is pretty awesome. And the episode was directed by our regular guy, in-house director, John Boab. So I will say ahead of time, I love this episode so much.
Well, that's nice that you got an episode out of this season that you loved.
Well, there've been a couple that I didn't mind. I wasn't mad at, but how do you feel about this?
It is another whimsical episode, David. So it's up there, but I mean, I wanted Nancy McKeon to fucking crack a smile just fucking once. Like, she could not have looked more angry that she had to do this dance. And I was like, okay. I did like the shed on lashes, though. I mean,
she looked good in the lashes. I actually have that in my notes. I like the lashes on her. And the one good thing is, even if she was not smiling because she was counting her steps, they all looked equally matched doing the choreography. That's the one good thing. There really wasn't a Beulah among them, which I was very glad, because sometimes these musical episodes happen and you kind of say, oh, wow. Yeah, we could have avoided some embarrassment there for this particular actor.
Like how they gave Tracy Partridge the tambourine and she just kind of hit herself in the head and kind of hit herself wherever it landed. And it was like, oh, let's not show Tracy Partridge, please.
The musical episode of Scrubs, where most of them can carry a tune, some of them even better than that. And then you have Sarah Chalk, where whatever they wrote for her, what little they did write for her to sing, it was like, okay, it needs to be in a low woman's or high man's register, and it cannot be wider than a three note range. So it's very obvious, like, oh, we know where things are lacking. And yeah.
Fun episode, though, and you can tell Bobby Rydell and Fabian are having a good time. They're adorable. Are.
And I think one of the fun things about the episode is the costuming. It is so just rich and comedically perfect in the costuming. And that I just realized I created the perfect segue for myself, for us, to cut away to our interview that we had with the costumer for the episode and for the entire seasons, 7, 8, and 9, our close personal friend, the wonderful Diana Eden.
I'm so glad I was able to get in touch with her and set this all up, being so close with her.
Yeah, you did you? So the email that I sent her and we responded back and forth to didn't achieve anything, you don't think?
Well, maybe the text I sent her saying, check your email.
No. Well, there it is. Once again, Matthew, you are the glue and I cannot refute it. So let's cut away to the interview. Let's let everyone hear our talk that we had with her. And then when we come back, we'll be able to get into our synopsis and our microscopic dissection. So let's take it away, you and me, with the wonderful Diana Eden. Here we are again talking to the amazingly talented costume designer Diana Eden. Hello, welcome back.
Thank you so much.
Well, as we are tackling the deep dive analysis of 62 Pickup, this is an episode that you've talked about already. I think it is mentioned in your book, Stars in Their Underwear.
I think so.
Yeah. I think we talked about it when we originally had our first interview with you. So you say you have stories about this episode and we are here to listen to them. So do you want me to just throw the ball to you or do you want me to ask you some specific questions?
Well, I'll start off with the clothes that were designed and made especially for the episode, which was Blair's little turquoise dot dress. I designed that, and it was made for her by Maki in our workroom, and of course fit her to a T. Was perfect for her.
Oh, like a glove, gorgeous.
Yes. And then the four dresses for their girl group, which were an orange brocade, and I always actually loved the 60s fashion. Those little A-line dresses were always just, you know, so easy to wear and so smart. But I got them designed and made. And even though the fabric was fancy, they looked a little plain. And I went to, the dear costume designer, Rhett Turner, who was one of Bob Mackie's partners. And I said, Rhett, they just need something else. What can I add to just give them a little extra punch? And he said, well, I either use great big flowers or boa. And of course, the moment he said boa, I knew that was it. Oh. So, So I added boa and they all loved the costumes. They all seemed happy and no one complained that the style didn't work for them and worked better for someone else. It really kind of worked for all of them. So they had fun with it too, which was great.
And Nancy McKeon didn't threaten NBC by saying she was only going to wear her tennis shoes instead of wear high heels.
Well, you know, the interesting thing when I rewatched the show last night, I'm looking at her in her heels and I'm thinking, she's wearing heels.
Yeah, how did that happen?
And I don't remember her fighting that. So they all got into it. Yeah, amazing. Yeah.
She's definitely wearing flats as Frizzo in the other outfit.
Yes, which is appropriate.
So those the four show dresses and Lisa Welchel's blue polka dot number, that was what you designed. Everything else was found and tailored.
Was shopped, rented, found. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And and then of course we had our two stars and they seemed to think the whole thing was a hoot. I mean, for them, it was just, fun. And the thing I remember with the hair is that the producers decided that, they needed to make them look like it was 1962 or 62. And then they needed more hair. So when they brought in the toupees for them to put on, they were just laughing. They thought it was the funniest thing they'd ever thought. I mean, put hair on to look younger, at that point in their lives. But they seemed to just be having a great time throughout the whole thing.
That does come through. You can see that. And and their pompadours were really, I was doing a little research on the two of them. The pompadours really were a signature for, particularly for Fabian. So that was definitely a smart move.
Yes, he had a lot of hair, you know, a good head full of hair. However, I made one terrible faux pas with the wigs. You know, all my training had been with Bob Mackie at Elizabeth Courtney Costumes. And I had seen all these incredible characters that he created for Cher or Carol Burnett. And Bob always designed the wigs. And there was this woman called Renata who made them. So when this situation came up, I knew exactly the look I wanted. And I called Renata and I said, can you make these wigs for the show? And she said, of course. So I got exactly what I wanted and was very happy and arrived on set on dress rehearsal day and took them to the hair department. And they were fit to be tied. And of course, in retrospect, I realized I'd been doing their job for them. I hadn't been planning to minimize them or overstep, but it was just the way I'd been trained. And of course, as you know, in theater, the costume designer very often designs the wigs too. So they were absolutely furious. And I have a feeling there were conversations that went on, you know, that to this day I don't know about. And I got my comeuppance because when it was Emmy time, they got nominated. Hair and makeup got nominated for that episode. So costumes didn't. So they probably felt, you know, but it was just my inexperience at the time, knowing how the movie world and the TV world worked.
Now, did you have the wigs made just for Bobby Rydell and Fabian, or the like the four, the beehive and the girls' wigs?
No, I did the four. I did all of the wigs.
Okay.
Especially the ones for them singing. Yeah. I'm not sure if I did the others for the girls at the beginning of the show. I might not have, but definitely the wigs that went with the orange dresses. Okay.
Those because you designed them, that makes sense that you would have had them.
Yeah, because I mean, it was part of the design. Yeah.
So they're like, we did these other wigs. Why in the world do you think we wouldn't do these too? Yeah.
Exactly.
The sentiment. Yeah. Was it any more or less stressful a production week because there was so much more to be gathered, made and all that? Or was it typical?
I think it was a big week. But you know, because we had a lot of things being made
And two guest stars
and two guest stars. We always did the show in 5 days no matter what. That was the schedule, and you know, that's how it always worked out. So it was probably a pretty intense week, and it wasn't a scary week because having been around in 1962, I was in my element. I thought, I've worn these styles. I can do that. You know,
had made them for your Barbie dolls when you were on tour with My Fair Lady, right?
Right. Yeah. I might have even worn my hair in a beehive at some point. It's quite possible.
There are pictures of your modeling days. Absolutely. I remember seeing some of those. They're fabulous.
Yeah.
So this, I'm very aware that this is probably stepping even too far. Asking for information. Do you have any awareness about the music, the production, the song? Did your path ever cross with the composer, Ray Colcord?
No, not really. And I think, you know, that's kind of a post-production thing. Though in this case, it wasn't post. But you know, we had the people that we saw and interacted with every day. And then there was this whole other part, you know, the editors and the music and the post that, you know, we were very unconnected to. The girls probably went and did a pre-record at some point. I don't remember. So, and I didn't know Ray Colcord had gone on to bigger and better things, you mentioned.
He went on to do some pretty high profile work. And yeah, I didn't expect that your paths crossed often because of the fact that typically the music comes in afterwards. But
yeah,
you can tell that there might be some studio singers helping with the backup, but you can tell it's them. They're doing their own singing it's quite well produced. It's impressive.
Yeah. And their little dance number was, you know, their movements were all, you know, perfect for that. So, it's interesting looking back and seeing the strengths of all of the girls. I thought Kim was especially good as her little character, you know.
They all really just, you could tell they ate it up. And Lisa Welchel historically has said many times she loved doing any of the bigger, broader fantasy nightmare sequences. You can tell she is eating this up. She is so happy.
And also it breaks up, you know, remember that back in the day of Facts of Life, we were doing 21 or 22 episodes a season rather than the six or the nine, you know, that are done now. So we were churning them out week after week after week. And so, you know, when we got something like this, it was great. We could get our teeth into it.
Sure. And I love Mac in his Dennis the Menace thing at the beginning with the running joke of him breaking the window with the baseball. And Cloris in her beatnik stoner chick beret. Oh, gorgeous.
Yeah. Oh, I'll tell you one little tidbit. Cloris and Mac were not originally in the nightclub scene. And not, you know, I think they were somewhere in the audience, but they were not really an integral part. And I think Cloris saw that this was going to be a, you know, a pretty big scene and insisted they write something so that she and Matt could really participate. So if I remember correctly, that came in, you know, halfway through the week, not from the original script.
And do you remember whose idea it was to put the goatee on Mac to make him, to see a 13-year-old boy?
Probably Cloris. Yeah.
It is so fun and funny to see that. And perfect to have her doing the beatnik poetry reading with the bongos. Oh, it's like that doesn't look imposed at all.
Yeah.
And speaking of that scene, I feel like it was when we talked to you that you mentioned that the atmosphere on set that day with performing and the guest stars, didn't you say that after you wrapped that it just erupted into a party, didn't it?
Yeah. The mood that night and for the taping was so much fun. I mean, very often, you know, we tape the show and then we'd have to do pickups and go back and pick up a couple of lines that had been dropped or scenes that didn't work and it'd be getting later and everyone wanted to go home. Well, not so for this, because we did the you know, the performance at the very end of the show. And everybody was just high on the energy and the fun. And it was one of the really special taping nights that we had.
Oh, that's how we hope it would be. When we watch an episode like this, we're like, I hope they're having as much fun off camera as they are doing all this stuff. That really warms my heart.
Well, most of the time it was like that. On the whole, it was a really happy set.
It seems like it was. And to know that they're all the girls are still close, that I think supports that. And Matthew, what else do you want to know? I think I've covered most of my big questions and you've already answered everything, Diana, I had wanted to ask.
Well, I love how they make it sound like it was ancient history. But now you look back and put yourself in the time period and it's like, oh, if they're talking 20 years ago from 1987 or whatever it was. So
25 years,
we'd be talking about 2002 or two. You know what I mean? So, my question, I guess, for you is, you said like you grew up around that. What was it like for you to meet Fabian and Bobby Rydell? Like, Fabian, let's talk. I mean, he could get it. So I mean,
Well, it was fabulous. I mean, I always looked to see who the guest stars were going to be, and you know, because that was my fun. I knew what the girls were going to need every week, more or less, and I knew what Clarice was going to need. So I would look and see who were going to be the guest stars, and sometimes they were, you know.
Well, there's a little difference between Orson Bean and Fabian walking up in front of you. You know what I mean?
I know. So, you know, when we heard that, we were all going, what? Really?
They were kind and they were nice and they were
terrific. Okay. They were like such good sports. They really were. It was like they were having fun. They weren't doing a favor. It was like they said, hey, you know, let's go appear on the Facts of Life and, you know, have some fun. So we all had a great week.
They seem to really like each other as well.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
That's great.
Oh, you're amazing, Diana.
Well, thank you so much, Diana, for jumping on the horn again. This probably won't be the last time. You know, we do have some other Lulus coming up as far as costume specific episodes. So as always, we so appreciate your giving us the time. Thank you again so much.
You are so welcome. Anytime.
So sweet of her to give us her time and talk with us. And we always, when I write to her, or I'm sorry, when Matthew writes to her and initiates contact, we do say to her, do you want to just answer a couple of questions and we'll just say it on the show? Or do you want to talk? And she's the last two times has been like, nope, I want to Zoom. I want to tell you my stories. I don't want to type this shit.
She's always good about hopping on a Zoom call.
So are we ready to get into the synopsis?
Do it. Give me a synopsis.
Let's do this. Tootie answers the door to find two celebrities on her doorstep. Teen heartthrobs, Fabian and Bobby Rydell. Sadly, Tootie doesn't know who they are. And the boys ask if they can get a peek at the old place. Because it turns out the house was once a well-known boarding house where traveling performers would stay when they passed through town. The boys had actually stayed there, but Tootie tells them to come back later when the others are home. Then later, as Beverly Ann is being told what happened, she digs out some of her old 45s and is reminded of the story of how one of the records by one of her favorite girl groups came to be. Flashback! We're now in the Facts of Life living room, but it is 1962, and it is known as the Blackbird Boarding House. Its owner is Mrs. Krebs, played by Cloris Leachman, dressed like a beatnik, who also owns the Blackbird Coffee House next door, but it is not doing well, and it is on the verge of bankruptcy. A little bit of a sidebar, Mackenzie Astin has a cameo as an incorrigible neighbor child who keeps breaking the windows with his baseball, a sort of Dennis the Menace meets Alfalfa type. So Fabian and Bobby Rydell arrive, playing their younger selves, staying at the house, and they are pursued by a bunch of crazed fans. Four particular fans break into the house, and they are played by the girls. Blair is Pinky, Joe is Frizzo, Natalie is Frenchie, and Tootie is Dee Dee, and they are an aspiring girl group called the Sha-La-La, La-La-La, La-La-La-Las. Why are you shaking your head? Because this is going on really long.
No, those fucking names were just, come on.
Oh, you didn't think it? I thought they were adorable.
I've heard those names before in a movie, Grease.
Yeah, well, that's what it's referential to. I think Frizzo and the fact that her wig was a bit frizzy. I thought that was kind of genius, but anyway. The girls want to show Fabian and Bobby a song that they wrote, hoping the boys might want to record it. Mrs. Krebs takes the sheet music and says she'll show it to the boys. But when Fabian and Bobby find the song on their own, Mrs. Krebs lies and tells them that she wrote it. Ooh, cliffhanger and commercial. When we come back from commercial, Mrs. Krebs tells the girls that the boys didn't like their song. But undeterred, the girls break into the house disguised as house painters. And to prove to Fabian and Bobby that the song is theirs, they perform it in its entirety with choreography. It is amazing. It's a song called Hot Rod Lover. Well, Mrs. Krebs fesses up and apologizes and says she only tried to steal the song to save her coffee house. So Fabian and Bobby take pity on her, offer to perform a benefit concert at the coffee house that night, which they do. The coffee house is the future Edna's Edibles / Over Our Heads space. The opening act is Mrs. Krebs performing some beat poetry accompanied by Andy on the bongos. And the main act is Fabian and Bobby with the shalala, la la la, la 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 la's backing them up, singing a song called Let's Put the Fun Back in Rock and Roll, to the excited delight of the crowd and the audience and me. And then we end the flashback back to modern times. Bobby and Fabian return and ask to see the room that they stayed in on the third floor. And everyone is saddened to realize that since the house doesn't have a third floor, likely the boys actually stayed at the house next door. Wop, wop, wah. The end.
Who wrote that, for Christ's sake?
I wrote that.
Jesus Christ, David.
But now, but that, so that
That's
was two minutes.
That's not a synopsis. That's a fucking scene by scene replay.
That's not. But now Jesus, we get that took 2 minutes. Is,
we flash back to 1962 with Bobby Rydell and Fabian, for Christ's sake. Oh my God, no wonder you never wrote for TV Guide. Christ.
Yeah, that's why. That's why they never called me. Well, whatever.
What the fuck are we supposed to talk about now? There you go. That's there. Good night,
well,
everybody.
No. The thing is, we don't have to stop, start, and then line by line by line. I just did that and we're done. Now we can just talk about shit and we're not beholden to having to follow a linear thing. The whole, you're getting ahead of us. Shut up. Stop talking. Okay. So what do you want to talk about first about the episode? How dare you?
Well, first of all, Bobby Rydell and Fabian are both 45 years old in this episode.
Fabian is like 8 months younger. Like it's very, very close in age.
Yeah. So 45. That's how old they are. This was 87. They talk about it being 1962. And I always get bothered when people, like, especially in the 80s, they're like, oh, the 60s were ancient history. Nobody knows anything about the 60s. And it's like, really? Because I remember growing up in the 80s and having radio stations. Granted, they call them the oldies stations.
It's true. So
can
true.
You imagine, which, like, if that were the case, like, they'd be playing stuff from 2002 on an oldies station right now.
But what I will say is that the thing to try to contextualize this, in the 80s, when this episode is happening, the 60s really weren't done. We were still trapped in this 1950s thing from, you know, Grease and Happy Days and all that shit in the 70s. That big wave of nostalgia still was kind of settling down. And some of the fashion from the 80s was referential to the 50s. But there wasn't a lot of 60s nostalgia going on at the time. Do you agree? I know you're too young, but.
I mean, this is about the time when Nick at Night was starting, right?
I feel like Nick at Night was more early 90s, wasn't it?
Jesus Christ. 1985.
Oh, it did. Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
I knew it was the mid-80s. I was a kid watching that stuff.
Yeah, but those were the shows that were already in reruns, like on the UHF stations. Like I grew up watching Bewitched and Gilligan's Island and The Munsters and I Dream of Jeannie, like Batman, all the stuff from the 60s. But there wasn't a lot of dress up, like the thing I've talked about before, that Andrea Martin as Edith Prickly looked ridiculous in the 70s. Wearing a 3/4 sleeve leopard print fur coat, pillboxy hat, and cat's eye glasses. That was a deliberate look to make her look out of date and silly. Now you look at her and you're like, that's pretty chic. That kind of works, you know? So that's what my thing is, that I don't feel like the 60s weren't being referenced and celebrated at this point in history. Certainly not the way the 50s had been over the last 10 to 15 years.
Okay.
But I don't know. I'm sure there's a fucking thesis paper somewhere where I could easily be proved wrong. But I guess what I'm saying is, for me as someone who was in this point, I mean, I'm 18. I'm about to turn 19 in 1987. So I do remember this time. And let's stop talking about me for once. I know, shock. But let's talk about Fabian and Bobby Rydell. Did you know who they were growing up? When did you know who they were?
Just like, and still to this day, I probably wouldn't be able to pick him out of a lineup. Like if you showed me a picture of a guy and was like, who's this? I'd be like, I have no idea. But obviously, Bobby Rydell, the name from the school in Greece is named after him, but
100%. Yep.
And just hearing the name Fabian, just because I listened to music that was from a different generation, but like I looked at pictures of him and Fabian was pretty beautiful. Bobby Rydell, not so much. But they were more like 50s singers. Like they were kind of like clean cut. I felt like they were kind of like the good boys, like Frankie Avalon kind of
and
stuff.
Yeah, you're Paul Anka and Ricky Nelson. Yeah. That's another thing to point out here. This takes place in 1962. 1962 is really, for all intents and purposes, the 50s culturally. There's not that much yet when you think of the 60s, the psychedelic Prince and the drug culture and the Manson family and ugly polyester clothes and bell bottoms. All of that was much later. And this is when we're still in the 50s. The hair was getting bigger. It definitely was. But the fashion and all that. And, you know, Diana Eden magnificently stuck to 1962, things we would actually see there. She never went to the late 60s, which could have easily been a place to go. And the way Chloris is, you know, portrayed as a beatnik poet. Beatnik, beat poetry, that's all 50s, man. That's late 50s, early 60s in a nutshell.
My issue is that she's a beatnik running a beatnik poetry cafe. I feel like Bobby Rydell and Fabian would have been too like lame-o for that, like for the beatniks.
Too mainstream, yeah.
The beatniks would have been like, these two nerds, you know, but that was just uncomfortable.
I hadn't thought of that, but you're probably right. You're probably right. Well, Fabian and Bobby, Fabian's last name is Forte, by the way. Fabian Forte, but he's just known professionally as Fabian. And I only knew Bobby Rydell from Bye Bye Birdie, playing the boyfriend of Anne Margaret, who sexually seems to be about three decades younger than she is. But, and I only knew Fabian from Laverne and Shirley because they were obsessed with Fabian. Laverne and Shirley took place in the 50s. And there was an episode where Fabian did come on the show playing himself. And it was a delightful episode, but I missed them completely. They weren't around. I asked Diana, where were they in the 70s? Why, for all of the square, I'm putting air quotes, for all the square acts that they brought onto the variety shows for the need for more talent, we never saw them on the Flip Wilson show. They never appeared on Donnie and Marie or Shields and Yarnell. And I wonder what is that? Why is that?
I wonder that too. I mean, Fabian made a pretty good career playing himself on episodes of like Laverne and Shirley and this. I mean,
true.
And he definitely did the game show circuit in the 80s. But they were never really like, it was about 89 or 88 when the Beach Boys released Kokomo.
Yeah. And
that kind of brought back that like concerts where you know, it was Fabian opening for the Beach Boys, or, you know,
yeah, the nostalgia circuit, as they say. Yeah.
Like you might see them on an 80s cruise now. Next to Cinnamon.
Oh. Well, I watched a lot of television in the 70s. We have established that over the past 183 weeks. But the deal is, I did not know who Frankie Avalon was when he appeared in the movie Grease. I heard the audience around me reacting a little bit, but as a kid who had been doing nothing but consuming contemporary television and reruns, I was like, I don't know this guy. I guess at that point I hadn't even accidentally stumbled upon a Beach Party movie to know who Frankie Avalon was. So that was just... that all just feeds into this thing of where were these guys during this time when it's clear they needed any and all talent they could get their hands on for the Carol Burnett Show and for Van Dyke and company and all that. But both of these guys are Italian, both of them born and raised in Philly. So their rapport, their comfort level, and their clear sense of play and comfort with each other is just delightful. I loved them in this episode.
Yeah, I think they got the joke.
Oh, you have said it many times. They understood the assignment and they did it beautifully. And one reason why this episode ages well, why it's so enjoyable to watch now, is they smartly included that first scene where Tootie is as the youngest of the kids. And remember, I'm a year older than Tootie. And Tootie is like, I don't know who you are. So thankfully, they got the chance to say, whoa, that hurts. Yeah, I'm going to cry all the way home and all that. But, you know, take it in stride. We used to be famous. We're not so much anymore. That was a lovely thing, because then we got Beverly Ann to tell us about who they were. The episode establishes that and reestablishes that for those who didn't know, for the facts that may have been lost to entertainment history. Bobby Rydell just died earlier this month. He just died on April the 5th of 2022.
Yeah.
That's sad.
Is that?
No, he was in his 80s. He lived a good life. He had a good career.
I especially enjoyed the anti-gay joke that they had, that they felt the need to make when
homophobia. Yep. At least that is timeless from the 60s to the 80s, ladies and gentlemen.
I was like, there's a part of me was like, sit down, Fabian. Ain't nobody knocking down your door. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Nice pompadour. How much time does it take you to fluff that up every day?
Jesus, not as much time as it probably takes you to fluff up Bobby Rydell.
Oh, yikes.
Ancient old carcass.
What we're talking about is when the girls are in disguise and we think they're men. Like, it's a Lucille Ball situation, very 60s, full face of makeup, full lashes, but mustaches and full body workman suits and hats, and they can't tell that they're actually women in disguise. So Natalie, as the horny one, is making comments and making a play, and it's like, whoa, stay away from that guy there. And then when it's revealed it's a girl, it's like, oh, thank God. Thought, yeah, I might catch the queer off of this fag.
Yeah, I didn't like that at all. Take a seat, Fabian.
Yeah, you take the good, you take the bad. Yep. So Missing from Syndication is a little bit from the following scene where now Beverly Ann and the girls are all talking to Tootie, and Beverly Ann is kind of bringing everyone up to speed. And there's a very kind of important little thing that I have to obsess on here. So this is where Andy says, oh, that music is prehistoric. And Beverly's like, shut your fucking mouth. And do you live here? I'm paraphrasing. But she says, and I'm quoting the episode now, I beg your pardon. That was my era and I loved it. Girl groups, doo-wop music, twisting the night away. Oh gosh, I was hip.
She was also in her 40s.
Thank you. You knew I was going there. You knew I was going to go there. Ladies and gentlemen, we have long analyzed how old was Edna Garrett And therefore, by association, how old is Beverly Ann as her younger sister? Well, keeping in mind that both Charlotte Ray and Cloris Leachman were born in 1926, they therefore, in 1962, both of them were 36 years old.
Going to sock hops and
exactly. I'm like, wait a minute. So that's how old the actresses are. Now, we talked about the best I can do the detective work. We think Mrs. Garrett was born around 1930. So the best scenario is that Edna would have been 32, or even take a couple years off that, which I don't think we can do due to the ages of her children. Edna would have been 32. Beverly Ann, even if she was 5 years younger, a 27-year-old in 1962, you were married with fucking kids, or you were a spinster. You weren't, like you said, you weren't going to sock hops and hanging around the soda fountain and playing the jukebox. So I'm glad you picked up on that too, where you're like, wait, what?
Yeah.
But yeah, she implies she was a teenager. So yeah, apparently she is. Well, let's look at it this way. She was born in 26. Fabian was born in 42. Bobby was born in 43. She is almost old enough to be their mother.
Yeah. She's 20 years older than these two guys.
So. Yeah. Jesus. But anyway, long as we've got that out of the way. And for those who saw the syndicated version, I'm sorry, you didn't actually get to see that little scene. But where we come back from the little cut is where Beverly Ann grabs the record and puts on the record for the initialization of the flashback.
And Cloris is so good as the beatnik.
Oh, like, my God.
The line deliveries, the stance, the line readings, especially, like, she really she overplayed it without overplaying it. It was brilliant the way she did it, like the way she would just end some of them on an like you would immediately think, like, oh, I'm gonna play a beatnik, so everything's gonna end on a downbeat. And but the way she would be like, what is happening? Like, she ended things on an up, and she was just little brilliant acting that she did in that.
And I don't say this very often. I really have to credit the script writing in that it gave her the language to also be able to explore that with things like, oh no, daddy-o, you cats are nowheresville, and all those type of tropes, which are just, I mean, put those words in Cloris Leachman's hands and she spins straw into gold. So magnificent. What'd you think of the set? The way they redressed the living room to look like its 1962 counterpart.
Why bother? I mean, what was that, for Christ's sake?
It was
still that color blue that.
Well, then they took the wallpaper, which was one of the only muted tones in the room, and they put panels in there, and they were pink. So we're in over our heads, bubblegum, baby blue. Like, I'm like, that color palette's not really a thing yet.
Yeah. Wow. And so, I mean, I was like, why? Okay. That seemed like a cheap half-ass kind of thing for them to do.
Mm. I noticed that the curtains at the back look like they might be camouflage. And then the sofa has this black and white leaf print. I thought it was zebra print at first, but no, there's a leopard print pillow that Frenchie keeps holding that's there. But yeah, they position the furniture completely different. And in the back, in that little alcove by the French doors on the right side, on the side of the front door, did you notice there's a counter and stools, like a little eat-in area? I guess, well, because the dining room table's not there, is it? Because the piano. Oh, a pink piano, by the way. How 1962? A pink piano? Really? So
the set dressing.
It was fine. It wasn't anything drop dead. Oh, my God. And they had like an antique TV in the back that was, you could tell was actual vintage. And it's like, if you had built something more fun, it probably would have read better.
Yeah.
Sometimes using the actual thing is not the best thing. And what's the other thing I wanted to say about the set dressing? When the girls break in, when we first meet the four, the girl group, they break in through the French doors in the back. Matthew, I do not think anyone has ever walked through those French doors since the first episodes back in the Edna's Edibles days. Remember we had that one episode where they were just coming in and out of random doors because they hadn't kind of figured out which way was best. And then it all ended on just come in and out of the front door all the time. Well, this was coming in. I was so shocked. I'm like, God, I didn't even know they still worked. I thought they just took the hinges off, for Christ's sake.
I just love like knowing that there's only like a foot of space back there, like that they were all lined up back there. But
oh God,
yeah. I did want to know why they didn't put Joe on the end, because Blair's the only Mouseketeer on the stage and she's being blocked in her choreography in the final scene. I did have a problem with that.
Yeah, that was
put
interesting.
Joe on the end. Hide Joe behind the two boys, because she's the one who's not having any fucking fun up there. And Blair is a Mouseketeer, for Christ's sake. This is her element.
They are in billing order, though, aren't they? In terms of from right to left, it's Blair, Joe, Natalie, Tootie. Age order. And they keep that consistent. They're in the same position in both songs. But yeah, they could have just swapped that or just, yeah, I agree, put Joe on the end. Want to talk about the costumes? We talked to Diana a little bit about them, but watching the episode again, God, they are just so fucking fun. The thing I love is how flattering it is, the fact that they all look good in these different, and it's four distinct different styles. You know, Joe is dressed as the tough chick with the leather jacket. Blair is dressed almost like a June Cleaver housewife in that Diana Eden original, the blue polka dots. Interesting that they're blue polka dots when her name is Pinky. It's like, why didn't you make it pink? Should have asked her. What was I thinking? Tootie has got a leather jacket on and some leggings and very high
heels.
She's
in capri pants.
Capri pants. There it is. And here's the thing. This is a fascinating thing about clothing and costuming. I'm not saying anything out of turn or judgmental when I say Kim Fields is a curvy girl and she is busty. And so often the 1980s fashion, because it was all based on blousing and, you know, belting and cinch it and, you know, big wide shoulder pads, there are times, even at her best, Kim Field looks bigger than we know she actually is. Watching her in this episode wearing something form-fitting, she looks amazing. Her body looks incredible. It's the weird thing where wearing tighter clothes, typically you'd think, oh God, don't wear tight clothes. I don't want to, you know, have my body's flush. But it's like, no, when you wear clothes that actually fit the body looks better. And it took us the better part of two decades, the 80s and the 90s, to figure that out. And oof.
I mean, never mind the fact, I know you're doting on the writing here, but never mind the fact that these four girls would never be friends, let alone
oh God,
a
no.
singing group, for God's sake. Like, yeah. I mean, they couldn't have, I mean, I get it for the comedy's sake. They're all playing this archetype, but it's like, okay, I don't think Frizzo would have wasted much time hanging out with Pinky over here.
True. And I love that they did variations on their existing hair colors. So you got your blonde, brunette, redhead, Blair, Joe, Natalie, and the wig that they have for Kim Fields, that beautiful caramely color. I am really all about Kim Fields' look for this show. It really, really is fabulous. I loved Andy's Dennis the Menace look, and then later the goatee, him with the bongos.
Putting him on the bongos. That was like a little bit of comedic genius, watching the two of those work together.
Yes. And right. and them doing some of the choreography on the sidelines too in the finale number.
Yeah.
And yeah, the beatnik poetry. I had to cut and paste this because God, it's so fucking funny. From deep within my screeching, howling, bottomless abyss, I greet the new dawn, a nightmare scream frozen in my throat. And then she tags it with, I call that my ode to spring. Just perfection. So speaking of the choreography, when the girls are performing both of the songs, that is a that's a lot of choreography that they do. It keeps changing. There's very little repetition in it. There's a lot of theme and variation, but I sat there going, wow, they did not take the easy way out. I don't know who they brought in to choreograph this, but wow, I was very impressed. And all of them really did a good job. Nancy could have smiled. That would have been welcome. But yeah, and Fabian and Bobby singing that final number, Let's Put the Fun Back in Rock and Roll. I assume these songs, by the way, were written by, as we talked with Diana, I assume these songs were written by Ray Colcord because he was the guy that did the music, but there's no credit for them. And they sound good. Whatever work they did in the studio with their voices, the pre-recorded sound certainly helps them sound more professional, but you can tell it's their voices and they're doing great with it. So Matthew, I can't believe I'm about to say this. I am almost done with all of my notes here. I have nothing else, just the joy of that moment at the end when the crowd jumps up and joins in and claps and sings and how joyous that feels as the viewer. And then to learn that that was such a real thing actually on the set. I fucking love this episode.
Oh, I hate to shit on the end for you.
What? Oh God, what are you going to do?
It's just, okay. They end the show in 1961 or 62, right? They end the show in 1962, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there are Fabian and Bobby Rydell singing a song about the old days.
Oh, wow. You are totally right. I totally missed that. You're totally right. See, I just got swept up in it, but you're totally right. And it's like a laundry list of let's all twist and shout and do this and that, and let's put the fun back. Yeah, in 1962, there was plenty of fun still in the rock and roll. It had been lost by 87. True. Wow. I didn't even think of that.
Just seems like they should have done He's My Backseat Romeo, I guess.
Hot Rod Lover.
It's a great song.
Giggity. It sounds a lot. It's a very common chord progression. So it sounds like a lot of the songs in Grease. And I swear to God, after I watched this, I could not get it out of my fucking head. I was hot rod lover like no other. He's my backseat Romeo.
Romeo.
So, and yeah, the only other note I have here is the final moment of the episode. We have not gotten enough of the comedic genius of Cloris Leachman. No, nay. Hold on. We still got more fuel in that tank. Where? Because she's meeting Fabian and Bobby Rydell. They're about to arrive. She runs upstairs to change. So, while she's up there is when they discover this is the wrong house and they leave. So after they're out the door, Cloris comes down stunning in a red dress, not the red potato sack and not the red Valentine's Day dress. This is a different red dress. Gorgeous. And it's just her running down the stairs going, are they here? Bobby, Fabian, and her running back to the kitchen and her running into the store and just running around like a chicken with her head cut off. And none of the girls saying, they're outside. Go out the front door and you can catch them, I'm sure. But just her just running around like a fucking idiot. And I'm just like, and yet she is still brilliant. How does she do it? She is goddamn magic, that woman.
She's a great actress.
Yeah.
She understood the assignment.
So true. So very true. Well, I think the thing I love about this, except for our show Bible moment of how old do they think that we think Beverly Ann is trying to pass for? I think because it's an episode that is deliberately set up to be broad and cartoonish, they can get away with more, and they do. I think they had the ability to go there, and they did go there. I didn't feel like there was a lot of missed opportunities or not taking it far enough.
Yeah, agreed.
So yeah, that's it. When an episode sets up your expectations and then delivers them, and at times even exceeds them, because I'm not sure we, well, I guess we did foresee that there would be a song because it's the record that is the precipitating event, as it were, for the flashback. But the fact that they had two very well-written, fun, polished musical performances in this episode, on top of all the other comedy and silliness. This is one of my all-time favorites. This might be at one of the top five, definitely a top 10 for me.
Okay. Could you just, because I know you're always looking for some sort of realism in it, then could you explain to me how Beverly Ann knows this whole story about the Shangri-La la 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 la's and their encounter with Fabian and everything at this building that she has, it's like
that she's only lived in for a few months now.
A few months. And then at the end, they're like, whatever happened to the shalalalalalas, Beverly Ann? And her response should have been like, how the fuck do I know?
But she says that's the story of how it is. Well, how did she put it? It's the line is something like, well, that's how they say the story goes. So it could just be that, oh my God, I'm totally living in the house. I remember there's a story about this group and this thing at some boarding house in Peekskill. It must have been here. I'm justifying. I'm aware that I'm justifying. You know what I have a bigger problem with? Beverly Ann saying, oh, I think I have some of my 45s buried back here. Bitch, why are they buried? You just moved in. Jesus. Why did you have to go out to the garage to dig out your sheet music with George Clooney for the piano when you just moved here? How much shit did you bring with you?
Well, grandma's sewing machine.
Up in the attic. Yep. That's still en route right now, by the way. It's still on a boat somewhere to Africa. Charlotte is calling Federal Express with a tracking number. Edna is, and trying to find out where it might be, if there's a delivery date in the system yet. Well, I think that wraps it up, darling. You have anything else you want to say before we head on out and let these lovely listeners get back to their day?
I find it fascinating that you finally let a little bit of whimsy and allowed yourself to like an episode.
Yeah.
And it took was Fabian.
It took Fabian. Did you see, you saw the pictures of him in his heyday?
Yeah.
He could get it.
He could have gotten it on this episode.
Damn straight. I would, 45-year-old Fabian walked in that sweater, by the way, which I want. I would wear that sweater today if I had the opportunity. But yeah. Mm. So, well, thank you, Matthew. And we definitely want to give our great thanks to Diana Eden for giving us that mini interview that we featured earlier. Don't forget, you can get your copy of Stars in Their Underwear, Diana's wonderful memoir, at Amazon.com. The link is in the show notes and on this episode's webpage. And next week, Matthew, we're going to be watching season 8, episode 19, Boy About the House.
That where Andy gets adopted.
Mm-hmm. Where Andy's entire family somehow dies or disappears.
Yeah.
You know what I think it might be? We haven't watched the episode yet. We need to look at this through the lens of, did it have something to do with Edna, the drugs, the feds, and the fire?
Mm.
Remember we said that Andy's parents maybe died in the fire or something. Maybe they were somehow involved. And hopefully the grandma just died of a heart attack a couple weeks ago. That bitch.
Yeah. The Moffat crime family of Peekskill.
Be Jake's Gill crime family. Well, if you want to watch the episode ahead, you can at dailymotion.com. That link is also in the show notes and on this episode's webpage. And that is all. Thank you so much for listening to the show this week. And remember,
you want to say it. Like, hey, man, the facts of life are like all about you and stuff. That was brilliant. Like Cloris as a beatnik delivery.
Brilliant.
Let's Face the Facts was created, produced, written, hosted, and edited by the wonderful David Almeida. Our theme song was beautifully arranged and recorded by Ned Wilkinson. Please visit facethefactspod.com for supplemental photos and videos, links to social media, and ways that you can support the show. And don't forget to subscribe, rate, and review. This is Matthew Arder saying tune in again next week for another thrilling episode of Let's Face the Facts.